Dear students, today I am going to take up a very important topic of your analytical chemistry. As you all know, analytical chemistry includes the deals about the qualitative as well as the quantitative analysis of a given substance. This is a very important point. This involves, the analytical chemistry involves two main parts. One is the qualitative, the other one is the quantitative. Under the qualitative analysis, you have already discussed different type of topics, and you have done different type of practical analysis under your first year, second year, and even in final year also. Under the qualitative analysis, you have analyzed the simple salt and a mixer in inorganic chemistry, and you have done the analysis of organic compound in the final year fifth semester part also. So now I am going to take up a very important topic of your quantitative analysis. Basically, I am going to touch few very important principles of quantitative analysis. Okay, let us take up in detail about the quantitative analysis. The quantitative analysis basically involves the characterization in the sense the exact quantity of the substance that is present in the given material. So, as you all know, the chemical analysis includes any aspect of chemical characterization of a sample material. That means, we are going to characterize the quantity of the substance present in a given sample. That is what we are going to take up in this particular part. And this is this particular part includes in under your elective paper, that is the quantitative separations and analysis, and this is a important part of your that elective paper. And now let us take up in detail about the analytical chemistry. And here in this chemical analysis, this includes different type of topics. That includes, one is the quantitation. One quantitation, that means how much quantity of substance is present in your given sample. This is the first part we are going to deal. The second one is the detection. Does the sample contains what is the type of sample, that is the substance that is present in that particular organic or inorganic sample, that is the detection. The third one is the identification. Identification means what is the identity of the substance in that particular sample. And the last one is the separation. Separation is nothing but the isolation or the removal of impurities and getting a pure substance. These are the four different type of parts that includes in the chemical analysis. One is the quantitation, that means the exact quantity we have to identify by means of using different type of techniques, which includes the volumetric analysis, gravimetric analysis, and so on and so forth. Detection, the sample, what is that exact substance that is present in it. And that the third one is the identification. We are going to do different type of test to identify that particular substance. And then the separation. Separation is nothing but the purification or the isolation of different type of mixers into individual components. And now, let us take up what a chemist or an analyst, that is that he is going to do in industry or in a laboratory. As you all know, after doing your graduation or post graduation in chemistry, you may occupy a different type of positions in an industry or in a research laboratory. You may find positions in the qualitative quality analysis, quality control rather, and the research and the development wings, and even the production wings also. So, an analyst applies his knowledge of chemistry to identify or to define the exact characterization of that particular compound. And a researcher, an analytical chemist, what he do is, he will develop new measurements, new types of measurements or the new types of techniques based on his knowledge to analyze the new given compound. And these are the different important things you have to bear in mind about the chemical analyst. Chemical analyst in the form of a quality control analyst or even in a research and development wing. Okay. Now, let us take up what is the analytical science. Analytical science or the analytical chemistry provides the methods and tools that are needed for identifying the material. So, finding solutions or the answers for four different type of four important things. That means, what is that particular substance that is present in it? First one is the what, and the second one is where, the third one is how much quantity of substance present in that particular sample, the last one is what arrangement of that particular structure or the form, that is the exact speciation of that particular given substance. These are the four things which an analytical chemist thinks about. The first one is the what is the particular organic substance or the inorganic substance, the given sample, and where it is, and how much quantity, that is the quantitization, or which is nothing but the quantitative analysis. And the last one is the arrangement of structure and which type of forms it is involving, and these are the different type of things, and I have given few different type of methods for identifying the above said four different things, like precision, sensitivity, selectivity and speed capabilities. I have given few examples, the gravimetric, tritometric, potentiometry, electrogravimetry, voltammetry, and different type of metrics, and even the chromatography is also there to identify or identify the substance both in the form of qualitative as well as the quantitative. And these techniques also involves are the based on the size of the sample, the what is the size you are going to get, that means the sample weight and the sample volume, based on that particular substance particular quantity also you are going to analyze different type of methods. And as I told you, this particular topic, the quantitative analysis, is a part of your elective paper, and the title of the paper is Analytical Methods in Chemistry. So, Analytical Methods in Chemistry, which can also be called as the Art of Science of Chemical Analysis. Under that, I am going to explain the first part, the volumetric analysis, and the second one is the gravimetric analysis, which is a part of your syllabus. These are the first two units of your that particular chapter. This is the Analytical Methods of Chemistry. This is the elective paper under this semester 6. Let us take up the things one after another. The first one I am going to take up is the volumetric analysis. Before actually going into the volumetric analysis, you need to understand certain very important keywords, like what is volumetric analysis, what is a titration, what is a standard solution, and what is a non-standard solution. If you know all these things, you can tell, you can understand, and you can tell about lot more things related to the titrations, the simple acid base titrations, and the indicators, the nature of indicators, and then the different type of theories that are involved in the acid base indicators. These things I am going to take up, and after that I will take up the gravimetric analysis also in detail. This is the these are the two topics which I am going to under this module. One is the volumetric analysis, the second one is the gravimetric analysis. The volumetric analysis is about as the name itself indicates, we are going to analyze that given organic compound and come to know the how much exact volume of the sample that is present in it. That is about the volumetric sample, volumetric analysis. And then let us take up the definitions of these particular things. First, a titration. A titration is a lab procedure where a measured volume of one solution, which we generally take in burette, is added to a known volume of a flask, and which conical flask we use for that particular purpose until the reaction is complete. So, we are using a burette and burette with one solution, and in conical flask with exact volume of the substance in another thing, and are going to perform the chemical reaction to take place by adding one to another. And now, before going into that, let us take a few very important things, definitions, like standard solutions and non-standard solutions. One, there are certain very important characteristic points laid down to be called as a standard solution. A standard solution is nothing but a solution of known concentration. exactly known concentration. A solution of exactly known concentration is called as a standard solution. And to be called as a standard solution, to prepare a standard solution, that particular substance, the solute, should have certain very important qualities, like that particular substance should be of very high quality, the first point. And the second one is, it must be stable in air. That means it should not change its chemical composition or the chemical form by means of kept in open air. So that is a very important thing we should bear in mind. This the another important point to be thing is, it should be easily be soluble in water. Next, it should have a fairly high reactive molecular weight, relative molecular weight. And these are the very important things. That means the standard solution for which we are preparing, it should have some very important qualities like this. And once the standard solution is prepared, its concentration should not vary. Once you keep it for a while, 1 or 2 days or 3 days, that concentration should not vary. And these are the very important things to be kept in mind while selecting a substance to prepare a standard solution. What are the different type of substances we come across in laboratories to prepare the standard solutions? Once a few such are sodium carbonate. One is a sodium carbonate solution, you can prepare a standard solution, oxalic acid, and then the potassium dichromate, potassium permanganate, ferrous ammonium sulphate. These are the few very important substances which can meet the requirements as I laid down for a standard solution. And now, let us take up the solutions which cannot be prepared as a standard solution. So, that means non-standard solutions. Then, as I told you, if the substances could not able to satisfy the conditions laid down by that, they are non-standard solutions. One, the sodium hydroxide absorbs carbon dioxide from atmosphere, and so this is a deliquescent substance. It absorbs the moisture from the atmosphere, and so it cannot be used as a prepare a standard solution. And HCl, it can also be not used for that particular purpose. Nitric acid, it easily gets oxidized and interferes with the reactions. And so, these are the substances which cannot be used for standard solution. There are so many, I have given very few examples for that also. Even sulfuric acid absorbs moisture because it is a powerful dehydrating agent, and it absorbs water from air. So, these are the substances which cannot be used for making a standard solution. What are the different methods to determine the end point? That means, to do the titrations, different type of equipments, different type of methods that are available. One is the pH indicator. The simple pH acid base indicator is used to identify an acid base titration, whether the reaction is complete or not, how the equivalence point can be known, which that we are going to discuss. And another one is the potentiometry. By means of using the potentiometric titrations, the potentiometer, you can identify the different type of complexometric titrations can be performed, the redox titrations can be performed by using the potentiometer, and even the pH meter. pH meter, different type of acid base titrations, not necessarily one acid and one base. You can use two acids and one base, and all these things can be performed with the help of pH meter. The pH meter is using the instrument, and the conductance, conductivity meter. These things you will also come across in your degree course while doing the practicals and all those things. In the next semester also, you are going to sixth semester also, you are going to do these practicals. The color change. The color change, as I told you, the visual indicators also used to do the identify the equivalence points and all. There are certain precipitation reactions are also there. Once you want to do the titration between the silver nitrate with the potassium dichromate and all, precipitation titrations are used for that particular purpose. And now, let us take up the acid base indicators. If we want to do the acid base titration, we need to have a visual indicator which is known as an acid base indicator. There are different type of acid base indicators that are available. Acid base indicators are nothing but the weak organic acid or a weak organic base. And I have given few examples for the different type of acid base indicators. One such one is the litmus paper. Simple litmus paper can be used, and the phenolphthalein solution, methyl orange, methyl red. In addition to that, I have given a lot number of indicators which can be used to identify the equivalence point in acid base titration. And these are the few things. I have given the pH range of each and every indicator. I have given the pH range of litmus as 5 to 8, methyl orange as 3.1 to 4.4, phenolphthalein 8.3 to 10. Based on the pH range, we are going to select an indicator for a suitable titration. And the litmus paper, as I told you, this litmus paper can be used for identifying the an acid or a base. This is a simple mechanism that is involved in the identifying the acid and a base. The phenolphthalein is a weak organic acid, and its structure is given like this. And these indicators functions at exact range of pH range is also given to that. Methyl violet, bromomethanol, and then the methyl orange, methyl red. I have given phenolphthalein and all these things. These indicators give one, they show one type of color in acid medium and another type of color in the basic medium. I have given the colors for an indicator which it exactly shows in acid medium and a basic medium. And the very important thing you have to bear in mind is there are two such important theories that explains the functioning of acid base indicators, the quinonide theory and the benzonide theory, which I am going to take up later. Let us take up the titration curves for different type of acid base titrations. First, I have taken the curve is the titration curve. Titration between a strong acid and a strong base, it will look like this. And in the x axis, I have taken the volume of sodium hydroxide that is added to the HCl. So, it is a titration between HCl and sodium hydroxide. And you can find the equivalence point, exact equivalence point at 7, because a strong acid and a strong base is the one which can ionize completely. And this is a simple thing. And for that, we can use indicator of methyl red as well as the phenolphthalein. Both that indicators can be used. Mostly the methyl orange and methyl red is used for this particular titration. And the very important thing to be remembered is the sudden rise in pH takes place, and the equivalence point comes at 7 for a strong acid and a strong base. Let us take up a titration between a weak acid and a strong base. I have taken a weak acid as a propionic acid, or you may take as a oxalic acid or any such to titration with a strong base like sodium hydroxide. You can see this is the ideal one. That means for a strong acid and a strong base, you should have a curve like this. But for a weak acid, a buffer region will be like here, like this, and its pH range falls at 8 to 10. So, obviously, we need to use an indicator which can show a sharp color change in that particular range. So, phenolphthalein is a suitable indicator to identify the titration between a weak acid and a strong base. And here, these are not used for this particular purpose. And these are the important things for a weak acid and a strong base. And another one, let us take up the titration between a weak base and a strong acid. Now, the titration curve will be like this. And here the indicator that can be used is a methyl red, because the equivalence point is in between 4 to 6 and the pH range of methyl red falls in between that. Okay. Now, let us take up the pH range of acid base indicators. I have given few examples for that, and these are the different type of definitions and other things which we have to bear in mind to understand the different type of indicators. And the functioning of indicators can be understood by using different type of theories like Kuhnoid theory and the Benzenoid theory, and this is all about the volumetric analysis. Now, let us take up the second part of the quantitative analysis, which is nothing but the gravimetric analysis. So, volumetric analysis is related to the identifying the volume of the substance, whereas the gravimetric analysis is to identify the exact weight of that particular substance given in the sample. And this particular gravimetric analysis finds use in the analysis of ores and industrial materials, and the calibration of instrumentation, and elemental analysis of inorganic compounds. Here you can use this gravimetric analysis, and the gravimetric analysis is a much more accurate, and you are going to get the exact quantity of the weight of the substance very easily. And there are different type of gravimetric analysis methods that are available. One is the physical gravimetry, the second one is the thermogravimetry, the third one is the electrode position gravimetry, and the fourth one is the precipitation gravimetry. And of all these gravimetric methods, we are going to discuss the method that is known as the precipitation gravimetry. And of course, when you go to the higher classes, you will come across with TGA, thermogravimetric analysis, and all those things, which are of very important and highly useful to know the exact quantity of the substance that is present in the sample. And the different type of things that are involved in this gravimetric analysis are, the once we take the volume of the substance, and we need to, for the precipitation gravimetry, we have to use a precipitating reagent. A dilute reagent is used in excess to get the exact precipitation. Once the precipitation is done and it is dried and it is weighed, and by knowing the weight of the substance, you can analyze the rest of the things. And these are the different type of steps that are involved. And once you know the different type of gravimetric analysis are there, one such is the estimation of barium from barium chloride solution. By for that we need to add the dilute sulfuric acid, take the exact volume of the barium chloride solution, add dilute sulfuric acid in excess. And once the sulfuric acid is added, you will get a barium sulfate precipitate. Filter it, clean it, and then dry it, you will get the exact weight of the substance that is present in the sample. There are different type of gravimetric analysis methods are there available, and you can analyze the same thing. You can do it for the silver chloride also, and different type of mechanisms that are involved for the precipitation. Induction period is there, nucleation is there, and how the silver nitrate gets precipitated as silver chloride by means of adding the hydrochloric acid. These things you can understand by means of going into the mechanism of precipitation and all those things. And to understand the gravimetry, we need to have the different type of terminologies that are available in this particular concept, and these are the things which you need to understand to understand the gravimetry in detail. Precipitation from hot solution, the precipitation from dilute solution, pre-precipitation and post-precipitation. These are the different type of terminology and the terms that are involved in the gravimetric analysis. And now, let us discuss once again the topics related to these things, the volumetric analysis as well as the gravimetric analysis. As I told you, the volumetric analysis is about identifying the volume of the substance, and the gravimetric analysis about the exactly knowing the weight of the substance. And the chemical analysis is useful in identifying different type of things like physical chemistry. You will find this organic chemistry, and then the analytical chemistry and all those things, and it finds the place in the biochemistry and different type of things like material science and all those things. And these are the important things which we have to understand to know the quantitative analysis in detail. So, I have taken up only two methods. One is the volumetric analysis, and the second one is the gravimetric analysis. Students, under this topic, I am going to explain the separation techniques. Separation techniques, different type of separation techniques that are available under a part of your elective, that is the chemistry elective paper. And the separation techniques in chemical analysis, the important topics that are included in your syllabus are mainly that deals with the solvent extraction. One such important topic included in your portion is the solvent extraction, and the different type of methods of solvent extraction methods are there, which we are going to discuss now. And in detail, let us take up different type of separation techniques that are available. In your syllabus, mainly the syllabus is for the solvent extraction and all, and their applications, and then the determination of different type of metal ions and something. Let us take up in detail about different type of separation techniques that are available in general. I will take up the most of the separation techniques which you have already studied in your lower classes and till now. I will take up in detail or in a quick session about these separation techniques. So, depending upon the physical and chemical properties of the substances in the mixer, we can appropriately separate techniques to isolate them from the mixer. Let us take up one after another. Based on their capabilities and the separation principles, we use different type of separation techniques like chromatography, filtration, evaporation, crystallization, simple distillation, fractional distillation, separating funnel, sublimation, and magnetic attraction. These are the different type of techniques. For each technique, there is one such physical property that is exploited to use this particular method. For example, if you want to use the chromatography technique, compounds in a solution with the same properties, that should be the main important key point for doing this chromatography. For doing the filtration, solids of group of solids and liquids in a mixer, such type of solutions can be used separated by using filtration and evaporation, crystallization, simple distillation, fractional distillation, and then the separating funnel can also be used for certain things, sublimation and magnetic attractions. Let us take up one after another in detail. This is a very simple decanting method which we come across in our day-to-day life also. Simply, insoluble solid is there and a liquid. Decanting method is used as a separation technique here. And then the filtration technique. Here in this particular part, you can do the filtration by using a suitable filter paper whose pores are smaller than the pores of the liquid that comes in. And now let us take up the evaporation. Evaporation is also a very important separation technique that is used. And here the evaporation, you take a solution and heat it, and then the unwanted substances will be removed at the bottom of the substance, and the pure substance will get separated by using this particular part. And the crystallization method is also there. There is a simple crystallization method, and where we use this dissolved heat liable substances, that is also a very important point to remember. A saturated solution is a solution that contains the maximum amount of solute dissolved in a given volume of solvent at a particular temperature. Here such type of solutions can be used, this crystallization. And now a very important thing is the distillation. This is a very important distillation separation technique which is used for separating purification or the separation of liquids. This particular process is used for using the solutions having different type of boiling points. And for example, if you want to separate alcohol from water, you can separate by using this particular simple distillation, because the boiling point of alcohol is 70 degree centigrade, whereas the boiling point of water is 100 degree centigrade. If you have to separate this particular mixer, boil it, and once the temperature reaches to 70 degree centigrade, you will get alcohol get separated, and then the water remains in that. Next, fractional distillation. This is a very important technique which is being used in industry in a large scale. And here the fractional distillation is used where the separation of liquids we are considering having the boiling points of 20 degrees centigrade apart. Then only this particular fraction distillation method is used. For example, if you want to separate the BTX, benzene, toluene and xylene, whose boiling points differs from 10 to 15 degrees centigrade, we can use this particular method for separating the benzene, toluene, xylene mixer, BTX mixer, popularly we call it as. And for that, the instrument will be like this. This is a fractionating column we use, fractionating column, where the separation is done here. And then the sublimation. The substances which has got the property of a sublimating property, like a camphor, ammonia, iodine, or such type of substances can be purified or separated by using this particular sublimation technique. This is a simple China glass is there, glass, and above that a funnel is put and heated. Once it is heated, a sublimation, as you all know, is a very simple physical property where a solid substance goes directly into the vapor state without undergoing into the liquid state. Such type of substances can be separated by using the sublimation process. And then the centrifugation. Centrifugation we use in the laboratory for separating the different type of groups in the mixer analysis or the salt analysis, and in the large scale the centrifuge instrument is used to separate the blood from the liquid portion. By centrifuging the blood, you will get a different type of components of the blood which we use it for analysis. And simple method, another method is called as the magnetization or a magnetic attraction. This is a substances which has got the magnetic property of the substance mixed with some other substance. By using a simple magnet, you can separate this. These are the simple separating methods. And the electrolysis is also a method where you can separate by means of electrolysis, you can split water into oxygen and hydrogen, something like that. And these are the different type of simple methods for separating. And now let us come to a very, very important concept of your portion, that is the solvent extraction. By means of using the solvent extraction, we are going to separate liquid-liquid extraction. We are going to do the liquid-liquid extraction. For example, we are taking a mixer of different type of liquids mixed together. By means of using this particular method, we can separate this mixture into individual components. We can separate one particular component and keep leaving behind the rest of the components into it. There is one such important law, that is the Nernst distribution law, that governs the separation of this particular property. And now let us take up this distribution law, or the Nernst distribution law. This Nernst distribution law states that it is a relationship between a solute, a non-volatile solute, when is added to two immiscible or the non-immiscible solvents. When a substance is added, when a solute is added to a two non-miscible solvents, and it which has got the ability to dissolve in both the non-miscible solvents, we can use this particular relationship as KDIC, distribution coefficient, which we call it as a distribution coefficient D. And here the C1 and C2 are the concentrations. C1 denotes the concentration of the solute X dissolved in the solvent A, A and B are the two solvents we have taken, and C1 is the solution that is formed by adding the solute to the solution, so the solvent A, and C2 is the concentration of the solution that is formed by adding this non-volatile solute to the that particular solvent B. By means of using this Nernst distribution law, the ratio of these two concentrations of the two solutions remains same, that is the given by distribution constant or the KD. And here the same thing you can view here. there are two immiscible liquids that are taken, two immiscible liquid. One is the organic solvent, which is in the orange, and the other one is the non-miscible liquid, a water-like solution. And here, this is organic liquid is the ether and the water we have taken. In this case, if you see, the substance, the solute is more soluble in the organic layer, and here this particular substance is more soluble in the water layer, aqueous layer rather. And this is this what we have explained by means of this Nernst distribution law. And now, this the same solvent extraction can be done by means of successive extractions, like by means of adding this particular solute repeatedly you will get a number of times. If you do it, that means the batch extractions, if you do, you will get more quantity of substance will get extracted into that particular substance. And this is one such method. This is the one where the organic compounds can be made to the water soluble methods, and this for that we need to use the substances, the water soluble substances. We can use the organic acids and then the amines, which has got the ability to dissolve water in it. And here something like there are certain other substances also that can be separated by using the beta naphthal, we can separate, and the benzoic acid we can do it. And these can be done by means of using the pH as a very important criteria. pH less than 7, both non-ionic, both will transfer to benzene, and we are using the benzene and benzoic acid here in separating. If the pH is 5, benzoic acid is deprotonated and says with the water. And if the pH is maintained at 11, both dissociate and both stay in water. These are the very simple concepts which we have to bear in mind while using the solvent extraction. And the solute should not associate or dissociate with that particular substance. This is a very important point to remember while using this solvent extraction method. And now, let us take up certain very important applications of the solvent extraction. The different type of metal ions can be extracted by means of using a suitable chelating agent. Here, the 8-quinol can be used as a very important chelating agent to separate metal ions from a given solution. Different type of methods can be used, and this is a one such very important method. Here, by means of using the solvent extraction, you can extract copper, uranium and other rare earths also from their substances. The very important application of this solvent extraction in industry is in petroleum refining industry, the extraction of automobile lubricating oils, aromatic hydrocarbons, paraffins and naphthalenic hydrocarbons can be separated by using the solvent extraction method. And there is another such industry where hydrometallurgy is used, rare metal recycling can be done by using the solvent extraction, where the bio separation and the environmental samples can also be separated by using this particular concept. The very important, another very important application of the solvent extraction is sweetening of gasoline. Sweetening is nothing but removing of sulfur from a petroleum product is called as the sweetening. The very important impurity that is present in gasoline is the sulfur, which can be extracted by using this solvent extraction method. And there are other type of purification methods, the applications of this solvent extraction, which includes industrial purification, extraction and recovery of metals such as uranium, copper, nickel, cobalt and rare earths from solutions. In all these cases, we make use of the principle, the solvent extraction. There are different type of solvent extraction methods that are available, very simple methods, batch extraction as I discussed earlier, continuous extraction, continuously by means of adding the non-volatile solute to the solutions, we can extract one particular substance. And the other one is the counter current extraction where both the substances are meeting in opposite directions. That is the Craig counter current extraction method is also there. As I told you, these are the different applications of this particular method. Cray counter current method, this is another extension of the solvent extraction method. And now students, we have discussed a different type of separation techniques which includes a commonly used fuse techniques we have discussed, and the very important concept of solvent extraction also discussed. The solvent extraction, a full length video, full length presentation was also available in the Mana TV YouTube lesson, where I have done some experimentation to show the exact solvent extraction concepts in detail about. Students, now I am going to take up another important separation technique which we come across in our chemistry, not only in chemistry. You can find this chromatography technique being used in other biologicals, biotechnology, biochemistry and other subjects also. You will come across this type of topics. I have shown the portion, that is the syllabus that is included in your the same lesson as a chromatography. We are going to take up the different type of classifications of chromatography methods. I am going to take up now different type of principles. So, what are the different type of principles that are involved in this chromatography? And in general, I am going to take up two different techniques at this moment. One is the paper chromatography, the other one is the thin layer chromatography. These two things I am going to take up in this module. And this is about the entire syllabus of one particular unit present in your elective paper. And now, let us take up in detail about the chromatography. What is the main history and how, what are the things that are led to the discovery of chromatography? This is the scientist, the Russian scientist Michael Svet, who discovered the chromatography. As the name itself indicates, chromo means the color and graphy, the separation. Based on the color pigments, he separated the plant pigments at the beginning, and based on that, chroma means a color and graphene means writing. This is the main history and the invention that was done by this Russian scientist. And very important thing to be remembered is as many as 12 Nobel Prizes, 12 Nobel Prizes were won by different type of scientists based on the applications of this chromatography subject. A very important thing, between 1937 to 1972, 12 scientists have won Nobel Prizes based on the chromatographic techniques, different type of techniques. Let us take up the very important basic concepts related to the chromatography. Chromatography, as we all know, it is a physical method and used for separation of components distributed between two phases. One is a stationary phase, the other one is a mobile phase. A stationary phase is the one which remains stationary, and the mobile phase is the one which moves above over the stationary phase. These are the two very important things involved in this chromatography. Whatever be the type of chromatographic technique you use, you have to bear in mind about the stationary phase and the mobile phase. What is the stationary phase? What is its physical state? What are its properties? We have to understand. And the same way about the mobile phase also. The chromatography process occurs due to the differences in the distribution constant of individual sample components. These are the important principles that are involved in this particular technique. And let us take up in detail about the chromatography. Let us take up the classification of chromatography on the basis of the mobile phase. If we take the liquid as the mobile phase, then we have different type of techniques like liquid chromatography, liquid chromatography and liquid solid chromatography. And if the mobile phase is a gas, we will call it as gas chromatography, that includes gas solid chromatography and gas liquid chromatography. These are the different type of chromatographic techniques, higher end instrumentation technique which are used to separate. Let us take up the another type of a classification based on the packing of the stationary phase. If you use the stationary phase as a thin layer, that is a thin layer that is coated over the glass or the plastic or the aluminum plates, then we call it as a thin layer chromatography. This is another type of classification based on the packing of stationary phase. Earlier we have discussed the classification based on the mobile phase, the nature of the mobile phase as the liquid mobile phase or the gas mobile phase. And here, depending upon the packing of the stationary phase, we can classify as the thin layer chromatography, where the thin layer is coated over the glass, plastic or aluminum. And another one is the stationary phase, where a thin film of liquid supported on an inner support, the paper is used, the filter paper, specially made filter paper is used as a stationary phase. And in the column chromatography, where the stationary phase is packed in glass column, we take a different type of columns, the different sized columns are there. We use the stationary phase is packed into that particular glass column. And here I have done two different type of classification. One is classification based on the physical state of the mobile phase, and the second one, depending upon the packing of the stationary phase, we can categorize it into the thin layer chromatography and the paper chromatography and then the column chromatography. And now, like another type of classification can be done based on the force of separation. I told you a mixture of substance is distributed between the stationary phase and the mobile phase. What is the binding force that binds the molecules onto the stationary phase moving along the mobile phase? Here if you can see the adsorption chromatography, where the adsorption, the surface phenomena, the concept is used to separate the mixture of components into individual components. Here you can see this adsorption under this adsorption chromatography is possible in paper chromatography and then the thin layer chromatography. This partition chromatography is also there. Partition chromatography, in the column chromatography you can find this particular part, and the ion exchange chromatography, where different type of ions are separated in the anion exchange resins and the cation exchange resin that comes under this ion exchange chromatography, gel filtration chromatography. These are the different type of classification based on the force of separation that separates the mixture into individual components. The last one is the affinity chromatography. These are the different type of techniques we make use of. Now let us take up the paper chromatography in brief. In the paper chromatography, we take a specially made filter paper, a cellulose fiber filter stationary phase, and here the second is the organic solvent flows past the sample on the paper. I will show you this part. This is the paper we use, and here this particular paper is hanged from top to bottom. This is a simple beaker we have taken here. The solvent front, this is the solvent front, the mobile phase and the stationary phase. This is the paper. Here we keep a line by using a pencil, not the pen or any such other material. By using a pencil, we put the standard line, reference line, where we put the sample which is to be separated here, and here the sample molecules, these particular molecules will flow along with the mobile phase to the top. While moving, these components will get interact with the stationary phase as well as the mobile phase. The molecules which has got the greater affinity towards the mobile phase will move farther, and the one which have less will move bit less. And depending upon the movement, we call it, we use the RF factor, the retention factor. The retention factor will help you understanding the nature of that particular substance. And here there are the different type of things we have to keep in mind while doing the paper chromatography. Choice of paper and the solvent are very important, and then the desalting of sample, application of sample, equilibration of paper, development and detection. For detection, we sometimes a naked eye cannot be used to identify the spots of that particular sample. We need to use the UV chamber or the iodine chamber to identify certain amino acids or such. Okay. Now, let us take up in detail about the other techniques. The multiple development of the chromatogram is also done by using this particular process. Multiple chromatography includes all procedures in which the development is repeated after one development is completed. Here a two dimensional type of chromatography technique is also available, where a large number of substances are to be separated and a single chromatogram that can be done by using the two dimensional chromatographic technique, and which can be done by using or by doing like this. Injecting the eluent from the first column and a second onto a second column. This I will show it in the paper. This is the one such paper where one particular sample is kept here, and another one is kept tilting towards, yes, this is the one particular thing we have done, one particular injection. You can see here, by means of tilting allowed to 90 degrees, we can do another one. This is the two dimensional paper chromatography. And here in this slide, I tried to show different type of techniques and a different type of phases, so the stationary phase and the mobile phase and the mechanism that is involved. I have shown in detail about the paper chromatography, the partition chromatography and all those things I have shown here. Here in the last slide, I try to explain the adsorption chromatography, partition chromatography, ion exchange chromatography, molecular exclusion chromatography and affinity chromatography. You know, I try to explain only one particular technique, that is the paper chromatography, in this module, and in the other modules we can come across with other important techniques like thin layer chromatography, HPLC, GC and so on and so forth. Mm-hmm.